So age combines what? Pedigree relationship matrix, what is the A, with the genomic relationship matrix, that's what is in G, we call G, genomic relationship matrix. So Steve talked a little bit about that before. So what happens is like that. So in sequencing, what we do, we just improve relationships. So we are kind of adjusting, making the relationships better. So let's say I have a sister, full sister, right? Let's say, what's the expected relationship between me and my sister? It's 0.5. It's expected that to share 50% of our DNA. Let's say that we genotype ourselves, and then it ends up that we share more than 50% or less than 50%. So this difference between the expected to the realized is what single step is making use of to get better accuracies. Okay, so now that you know what single step is, I'm just going to go through what I'm going to talk today. I'm going to talk a little bit about validation, some validation methods that we use to confirm that genomics is performing better than the traditional evaluation. And I'm going to talk about some specific scenarios here, like for binary traits or convertible traits like MEs, for traits that have maternal effect. I'm going to talk a little bit about large-scale genomic evaluations, about what we call indirect predictions, like to get DGVs, as Steve said. And I'm going to touch a little bit on some recent projects that we have at UGA. So I really like to show this picture here, because it shows that the number of genotyped animals is increasing very fast. And another thing that shows, it shows the commitment of the producer, the breeders, with genomic selection. So they are really engaged on that. And this is pretty good. So this one is a graph that we have for American Angus Association. So right now, as Steve said, as Dan said this morning, Steve said as well, they have more than 500,000 genotyped animals. This is not the biggest cattle data set in the US. If you think about the US holsteins, they have over 2 million genotype animals. But I think 500,000 is really amazing. It's like a huge data. Andrew, how many genotype beef cattle do you have in Ireland?
1.2.
Okay, beef cattle. Yeah, okay. So they had a huge project to genotype animals. Okay, so what happens is that we did some validation here back in 2014 and also in 2017 to see how genomic information was doing, so how single step was doing it. And then so for the data, the two different data sets, so we have here for the 2014 data set, we had about 8 million animals in the pedigree, 6 million records for birth weight and wean weight, 3 million records for post-wean gain, 52,000 genotyped animals, although they had 82,000 in 2014 when I got this data first. I just used 52,000 and I removed the animals that had no phenotypes at all in the data set. And then we validated on animals that were born in 2013, so about 18,000 young animals. Why young? Because to do the validation, we remove phenotypes for those animals, and then we run the evaluation, traditional one, we run single step. And then after that, we see which one of them is doing a better job predicting the future performance. And then for the 2017 data set, we had more animals in the pedigree, more phenotypes. We had about 335 genotype animals, and we validated on the same number of animals. They were not the same animals, but then I used the same number, and they were born in 2016. And how we calculate this predictive ability, the ability to predict future performance, we just correlate adjusted phenotypes with EDVs to get the predictivity for traditional evaluation, and adjusted phenotypes, so phenotypes adjusted for the fixed effects in the model. This is what I'm talking about, with GBVs for single step. And then the first bars here, the blue bars, show the predictive ability for the traditional evaluation that we call one. And then the green one showed predictive ability in 2014. So we can see an increase in the ability to predict future performance in 2014. And what about in 2017? So we saw increase as well if we compare with 2014 and with Love. So this tells us that we are keep improving the system by using more data, more phenotypes. So this is a very good news here. And if you compare with the traditional globe, the gain that we had in 2014 was 25%, and the gain in 2017 was 36%. So this was for growth rates, right? Birth weight, mean weight, post mean weight. And then we also did some validation for cabin ease, and this became very interesting. So we used the data from 2017. We used about 9 million animals, 8 million records for birth weight, 1.5 million records for cabin ease, and Angus runs a two-trait model, so birth weight with cabin ease. So we consider birth weight as linear and cabin ease as categorical data or binary. I'm going to explain that later. And then we used 300,000 genotype animals, 6,600 were born in 2016, so those were our validation data. And then predictive probability was calculated the same way, correlation with adjusted phenotypes and EBVs or GBVs. But the thing is, so cabin ease is reported, so we have several categories, but then at the end we have just two, we combine just two. So one is easy cabin and two is difficult cabin. And then the phenotypes are just binary, one or two. And then, does it make sense to adjust those phenotypes as they are like binary or categorical? And another thing is that the ABVs that we get, or GBVs from the system, they are in a linear scale. They are like a continuous scale. So does it make sense to correlate them, to correlate the adjusted phenotypes with ABVs or GBVs? Well, in 2015, we tested that, so correlated with adjusted phenotypes, and we saw that the increase in accuracy by using genomic information for cabin ease was very small, it was just 1 point. So we were wondering if this was really the case, that genomics was not helping much, or this was because of the validation method that we were using. So maybe using just correlation of adjusted phenotypes with EBVs or GBVs would not make sense. And another thing is that in the model we have maternal effect. So how to validate for the maternal effect? We tried several ways. So we tried to correlate adjusted phenotypes with the maternal EBV for the animal. We tried to correlate adjusted phenotypes with EBV maternal for the dam of the animal. And we also tried to correlate adjusted phenotypes with EBVs for total maternal. But then it seems it did not quite work. So in this case, sometimes we think, okay, maybe genomics is not working very well because the increase in accuracy or predictive ability is very small, but the thing is sometimes we are not using the right method to assess this gain in accuracy. So we were trying to find some models that or some ways to do the validation that could help us, and we found this method called LR. So probably some of you may know those guys in the picture. So we have Andres Vergara, and we have Tony Reverter. So they created this method that's called LR, so it's based on linear regression metrics, although I think it's called LR because of Vergara and Reverter, but they don't admit that. And it, what is interesting here is that this method was created based on the method R that was developed by Tony Reverter when he was doing some studies here at Colorado State University in 1994. And what this method does, actually, is to check the consistency between consecutive evaluations. So we have a partial evaluation without phenotypes for validation animals, and we have a whole evaluation with phenotypes for the validation animals. So we are comparing EBVs with partial data and EBVs with complete data. And this is for EBVs, and then for GBVs we do the same, we compare GBVs with partial data and GBVs with complete data. And then it works in the same way, actually. So we have to define which animals are validation animals, and then we remove phenotypes for them, and then we run the evaluations. And then they propose some metrics here. These I have some formulas here, but don't pay much attention to the formula, just pay attention to what I'm saying. So we have a relative increase in accuracy of EBV. That it's measured as correlation, it's just correlating EBVs from partial and EBVs from the whole evaluation. And if we want to see the relative increase in accuracy for GBVs, we compare the correlation between GBV partial and GBV whole. This is what we do. And then we can, if we want to see, okay, how much are we gaining yet in accuracy, we just divide the correlation of GBV partial and whole by the correlation between EBV partial and EBV whole. This is what we do. And then we have some measure of inflation here, which is the regression coefficient. Regression coefficient of EBV whole to EBV partial, or GBV whole, GBV partial. This is what we do. And okay, we decided to compare what happens when we use the regular validation, correlation between adjusted phenotypes, and the correlation from the LR method. So here is the correlation between adjusted phenotypes and EBVs and GBVs. So in blue, we have the traditional evaluation, and in green, we have the single effect. And then we have for direct and for alternative effect. And then when we look at the gain in accuracy, the increase in accuracy or predictive ability by using genomic information for the direct effect was 38%. And then for the alternative effect was 86%. But 86%, but moving from 0.02 to 0.04 does not mean anything. So this tells us that we are not being able to predict anything. But then when we use the LR method, we could get some reasonable values here. And then those values, they do not mean accuracy per se. We need to divide by, we need to account for selection actually. But anyways, what's important here is that when we use this method to track that data, we saw that the gain in accuracy for the direct effect was 38%. So it's similar to the direct effect when we use the correlation, the other one, right? And then for alternative effect, the gain was 7%. And I think 7% is much more reasonable than 86% because actually we are not removing a lot of data that could affect the prediction of the alternative effect. And the things get very interesting when we look at the inflation. So this B1 coefficient, this B1 should be close to 1. If it's 1, there is no inflation in the evaluations. And then we saw here that when we use the regression of adjusted phenotypes on predictions, this B1 was very close to 0 for direct and for alternative effect. So this tells us that this adjusted phenotype and the ABVs or GBVs, they're not the same scale, so we cannot compare using this method. And then for the LR method, we saw that the B1s, they were close to 1, so meaning no inflation in the evaluation. So what I wanted you to get from this message here about this validation method is that sometimes we think that the method that we are using is not giving us, or we think that genomics is not working, but sometimes we are not using the correct method to try to assess this gain. So we need to try to find methods that will compare the things in the same scale. And then, but still this method is just for you to keep in mind because we still need to develop this method better, and we need to do some tests for some extreme scenarios. And okay, this is just to keep in mind. So moving a little bit, talking about some extreme things as well. Right now, as I showed you, we have a lot of data, a lot of genotypes. And not all organizations, they have a lot of genotypes. This is something that few organizations, they have. And we have been putting a lot of effort to try to work with this huge amount of data. And there are several methods right now that are able to work with this big amount of data. So we have what we call single step API that I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. This is what Angus is using, single step with API. We have what we call indirect representations of G. So instead of constructing the genomic relationship matrix and inverting, we just like, we do some methods, we have some ways to calculate instead like SNP effects, like what single step Bayesian regression is doing, or the super hybrid model. And we have other techniques as well that have been developed here. That one example is this SSGT bluff that probably you are going to talk about that. And people from Ireland, they tested this method, right? And if we compare those methods, if we compare API single step with single step GT bluff, or if we compare API single step with the super hybrid model, what differences are we going to see? Actually, those models, they are equivalent. If they are equivalent, they should give us the same type of response. They should give us the same at UGA, we came up with this method that we call AQI. So now it's how single-step with AQI looks like. So what we do here, we are still carrying all genotyped animals. We are using all genotyped animals. But some genotyped animals we put here inside the truck. And other genotyped animals we put here in the trailer. We still are using all of them. But if you hear about single-step AQI, you know what that means. So we just split genotype animals, we put some inside the truck and some in the trailer. What does that mean? Okay, so I'm going to tell you what does that mean. But the thing is, AQI, some people think that AQI does some magic. AQI does not do any magic, it's just an algorithm to construct the G inverse, the inverse of the genomic relationship matrix, when inverting the matrix is not feasible. We don't have resource to invert that because it's a huge computing cost to invert a matrix. So what happens is that this AQI was based on the dimensionality of the genomic information. What's that? So we observe that when we have more genotyped animals than the number of SNPs, so how many SNPs, like in Angus, they use the 50K, so 50,000 SNPs. When we have more genotyped animals than the number of SNPs, we have some linear dependencies in G, in the genomic relationship matrix, meaning that some lines, they may be singular. Some lines may be singular, or the sum of two lines may result in the third line. So, because of that, we cannot invert the matrix. If we have this, we cannot invert the matrix. But actually, we observe that even before, even when we have like 5,000 genotyped animals or 2,000, we can have problems with inversion. We cannot invert this matrix. So what happens is that Paul Van Ray in 2008, he said, okay, to avoid this problem, let's just like blend the matrix. We get 95% of the genomic relationship matrix, and we combine with 5% of the pedigree relationship matrix. If we do that, we are going to increase the diagonal of the genomic relationship matrix, then we can invert. So this is what he proposed. So by knowing that we have some linear dependencies in G, it tells us that G has a limited dimensionality. So although we can genotype 2 million animals, 5 million animals, some of this information may be redundant. Some of this information, we may have animals that have the same genotype or the same relation, genomic relationships. So what happens is that in G, we have some blocks, some segments that are linearly independent, and we have some blocks that are linearly dependent. What happens is that the linearly independent blocks are the core animals, and then the core animals are the ones that we put inside the truck. They're the ones that we put inside the truck. And the independent blocks are the non-core animals, that we call non-core, are the ones that we put in the trailer. So this is what we do. And then what is interesting here is that the number of core animals, the number of animals that we are going to put inside the truck, is dependent on the dimension, is dependent on the population that we are working with. So for Angus, we calculated that the dimension or the number of core animals is about from 11,000 to 14,000. And then for Holsteins, it's from 14,000 to 19,000. For Jerseys, it's from 11 to 16,000. For chickens, it's from 4 to 6,000. For pigs, it's from 4 to 6,000 as well. So those are the number of animals that we need to put inside the truck. And then what we do here in the method, we say, okay, we have here all genotyped animals. Let's say we have here 500,000. We just split here, okay. Let's say we have, for population. So what happens with the number of core animals, the number of animals that we put inside the truck? Is it going to be bigger? Well, if we have more breeds, we are going to have more segments, different segments in the population that we need to represent. So at the EGA, we don't have access right now to multi-breed genomic beef data, but we have access to swine data from PIC. So what we did here, this was done by Ivan. He's a postdoc in our lab. So he calculated the number of core animals, and for we had here two lines and one crossbred. So for line one, we had 27,000 genotyped animals. For line two, 16,000. For F1, we had 4,000. And then he calculated the number of core animals for the lines separately, for both lines together, and for both lines plus F1s. This is what he did. And then here is the number of core animals for line one. So for this big data set, although they had 27,000 genotyped animals, 3.8, they were the core animals. And then for line two, they had less genotyped animals. They had 16,000 genotyped animals, but still the number of core animals was 3.8. And then for F1 was almost 2,000. So when he combined those two lines and calculated the number of core animals, what happened is that this number was not the sum of the number of core animals in the two lines, which means that the two lines are not fully independent. And then when he included here F1s as well, the number of core animals did not change. It's still 5,300. And why is that? Because the F1s, they are progeny of animals from line one and line two. So they share the same segments with animals from line one and line two. And who is using single step with AQI right now? So a lot of people ask me about that. So a lot of companies in the US, they're using single step, but single step with AQI is being used by American Angus. So they have 500,000 genotyped animals, as I told you before, about 19,000 core animals. They run evaluations weekly for all traits that they have, that they collect. And it takes about 2 hours to set up this genomic relationship matrix. And Zoetis is also using that, and they're using for some hosting evaluation. They have these wellness traits that they provide evaluation for, I think, 7 traits, health traits. And I think they have about 500,000 to 600,000 genotyped animals right now. And I told you before that US hosts, they have about 2 million genotyped animals. So is it feasible to run an evaluation with 2 million genotyped animals? This is what we are going to test soon. We have a researcher in our group called Yutaka Masuda, so he's going to try that. And we think it will be feasible if we use APY. Otherwise, it will not be feasible because it would require about 29 tera of memory to do that. So, moving a little bit, I remember that when we were working with Steve and Dan on the implementation of single step for American Angus, Dan and Steve, they asked me, so when we have single step, the outputs, they are GBVs. But can we have SNP effects from single step? Yeah, we can have SNP effects. And they do need SNP effects because they have some commercial products like the GeneMax. So GeneMax is a product that they developed with Zoetis, and they provide genomic predictions for non-registered animals. So for them, it's important to have SNP effects because once they have SNP effects, they can just genotype those animals, and they just multiply the genotypes by the SNP effects, and they can get genomic predictions for those animals that will never come to the official evaluation. And then this is how we get SNP effects in single step. So when we run single step, we have GBVs, but then we can back solve GBVs here to get SNP effects. And then when we have the regular single step, we just use gene inverse. But what if we have, we are using APY, so we're using all genotyped animals. Can we still have calculate SNP effects? So this is something that we also investigated. If we could calculate SNP effects from single step when we are using 500,000 genotyped animals. Here we did not test 500 yet, but we are on the way to So we used the data back in 2014 to do that. And then we had 81,000 genotyped animals. The animals born up to 2012 were our training animals, so 66,000. The animals born in 2013 and 14 were our validation animals, so we used 15,000 validation animals. Then we did a complete evaluation and a reduced evaluation. The complete evaluation, we used phenotypes up to 2012 and genotypes up to 2014. So the validation animals, the genotypes for them were in the evaluation. And then we had a reduced data where we used phenotypes and genotypes up to 2012. So the validation animals were not there. We did not include validation animals, but we got predictions based on sleep effects. And we correlate this prediction with GBVs from the complete evaluation. And then although we did that for a treat rate model with maternal effect, I'm just going to show results for post-weaning gain. And then what we did here, we compare, okay, let's say we have the full genomic relationship matrix. We have the genomic relationship matrix from APY, and we have the genomic relationship matrix just for the core animals. This is what we did. And then here is the comparison of sleep effects. So when we calculate sleep effects based on the G inverse, and G inverse APY correlation was very high. But between G inverse and G inverse just for the core animals was 0.93, so this we were not expecting. We were expecting a higher correlation. But although this correlation was low, when we calculate the predictions for those animals, ZU or DGV, we saw that correlations were 0.99. So this tells us that we can just use a subset of genotyped animals to calculate sleep effects from single step. Or if you want, we can use G-inverse APY. And then another discussion that we had was, okay, let's say that at Angus they run evaluation every week, but let's say that we run evaluation every month and the genotyped animals, genotypes are coming every day or every week. So can we have some predictions for those animals, some interim evaluations, and then compare them with GBVs later? So this is what we try to do as well. And then if we have that, we can kind of give quick evaluations, like we can have predictions every day or every week. And then here is just to show you what happens when we use single step. So single step gives us GBVs. Right. I'm very used to GBVs, but for producers you use EPDs, right? Genomic enhanced EPDs, but it's the same. Genomic enhanced EPDs is half of genomic EPDs. And then okay, so we have GBVs. So we have here some contribution from parents, so parent average. We have contributions from phenotypes, contributions from progeny, contributions from the genomic relationship matrix, what we call DGV, direct genomic value, and we have pedigree predictions. And then, but when we have a young animal has no phenotypes, has no progeny. So for a young animal, GBVs are just paired average, DGV, and pedigree prediction. But then, we saw that as we have more genotyped animals, what happens is that DGVs and GBVs, they're very similar. The correlation is like higher than 0.99. So in 2015, we published this paper where we say, okay, the correlation between GBVs and this ZA, what we call, I used to call direct predictions, so ZA or DGV or direct predictions is the same. Correlation is higher than 0.99. But then after some time, after we published the paper, we saw that although the correlation was very high, average GBV was about 100 for post-weaning gain, and for ZA was close to zero. Meaning that if we want to compare animals that have GBV or animals that have indirect predictions, we cannot compare them in the same base because the values are not comparable. So can we have a way to compare those values? So if we have interim evaluation, can we compare it with GBVs? So we tested some methods for doing that, and we'll just skip this. Just details. But we tested three methods to do that. I'm not going to talk about the methods, but I just want to show you here what we did. So when we have just traditional blood, traditional evaluation, the base of the pedigree. Are the base animals actually are the founders of the pedigree. But when we have single step, we put animals that are not genotyped with animals that are genotyped, we put them all together. And then there is this difference between pedigree and genomic base. So we try to account for this difference and make the direct predictions comparable to GBV. So here, what we have is difference between GBVs and indirect predictions. And then if the indirect prediction is just ZA, we just multiply the SNP content by this loop effect. We have a difference here that we call bias, which was close to 100. But then when we added here average GBV for the animals in the evaluation, we got that indirect predictions were close to that. So we can say that if we want to compare animals that have direct predictions with animals that have GBVs, we need to add average GBVs for those animals for the direct prediction. So direct prediction will be equal to average GBV plus ZA. So from this one, we can say that, okay, after we do some corrections, we can have direct predictions that are comparable to GBVs. And if we are to calculate direct predictions, we can use SNP effects that are based on gene versus API or just part of the four animals in the gene inverse. So, I don't have much time, right? But the thing is, I just want to talk a little bit about what we are doing at UGA, because we are working with this indirect prediction, and there are some commercial products that rely on SNP effects. We are now on the way to implement a way to calculate accuracies for those indirect predictions. Because we were asked by Zoetis and by Angus as well for a way to calculate accuracies for those indirect predictions. So we just implemented that, so we are testing right now. We are right now also working on changing formulas to calculate SNP variance and what does that mean. So sometimes people think that in single step, when we use single step GBLOB, we cannot account for the fact that SNPs explain different amount of variance, but we can do that. We can put different weights for SNPs. And then we just change the formula that we use to calculate that. And I think probably Kelly is going to work on that on her PhD, right? We are very interested as well in multi-read evaluations, in bias, in genomic evaluations, and this is basically for dairy cattle. We are working on this dimensionality of genomic information. We are always trying to improve single step and single step with API. We are also doing some work on sequence data in single step. And another thing that we do at UGA, we develop software. So we have two Japanese guys that are very good on that, two researchers. And right now we just released this software to do quality control of genomic data. So what is that? When we receive the genomic data is not clean. So we need to remove like duplicates, we need to remove SNPs that are not called in the same animals. So we need to remove SNPs that are not following the Mendelian inheritance. So we do a lot of cleaning in the data. And then we had a software to do that that was not so efficient, but right now Yutaka implemented this new way to calculate, to do the quality control. And then we have a software now that is about 3 times faster, and it requires about 30 times less memory to do the quality control. So with that, I think my talk was very scientific, not so technical today. But anyways, that's why I put some take-home messages here. And the thing is, single step. What you need to understand is that single step is the new standard for beef cattle genomic evaluation. And all the industry is moving to single step now. And I need to tell you that this method is under constant development at UGA or several other universities as well. We have several groups, some groups in Europe that are always trying to improve this method. And for us, the scientists, what we need to do, we need to keep developing and improving methods. This is our job. This is what we have to keep doing. And for producers and breeders, they really need to keep collecting data. So the models and the methods that we develop, they are fully based. important to have phenotypes, especially for traits that are hard to collect, and pedigrees and also genotypes. So with that, I think I can take some questions.
We have questions for Danielle.
Contribution.
Any other questions?